Good morning. I continue to be amazed by the sophisticated work and inspired by it from that video and the work that students around our state are doing at the colleges and universities. I'm Francis Schodowski, Executive Vice President of Columbia College and SC Bio Board Member. We at Columbia College, like other universities on the board, are focused on preparing the next generation of scientists, doctors, and entrepreneurs to join the ranks of the amazing life science-related companies here in the state, or to create their own. Bob Quinn, Executive Director of South Carolina Research Authority, will moderate this next panel of rockstar entrepreneurs and executives, entitled Leveraging the Innovation Ecosystem to Build Stronger Teams. This panel will include Dr. Jeremy Mercuri, Samaritan Biologics and Director of Clemson Bioengineering Master's Degree Program, Ken Deans, CEO, Health Sciences, South Carolina, Rhonda Dean, CEO, Afaxys, Dr. Robert Ryan, founder, Innova Therapeutics, and Dr. Christine Carr, Chief Clinical Officer, Health Sciences, South Carolina. Please join me in welcoming the panelists to the stage.
Sugar sweet, but jumping queues and making haste just ain't my cup of meat. Everyone's beneath the trees feeding pigeons on a limb, but when Quinn the Eskimo gets here, all the pigeons gonna run to him. Come on without.
So it's part of my contract that that's my walk-on music whenever. A little trivia, that was written by Bob Dylan. Yeah, Manfred Mann did that, but Bob Dylan wrote it. Good morning, and if you would indulge me with a point of privilege to kick things off, and in no way wanting to put a pall on these proceedings, quite the opposite, but as someone who's grandparents emigrated to the United States from Ukraine, I would ask for your prayers for the people of Ukraine today and in the days, weeks, months, and perhaps years ahead. So thank you. Now, with that negative start, let me kick off a really wonderful panel. I was going to read their bios, but it would take us the entire session to fully give full shrift to the incredible background and expertise of this group. It's highly distinguished and quite diverse as well. Now, I don't have a microphone, but I have a stool. So if I could borrow that. Thank you. So I'm going to direct some specific questions to each of you, but I would invite all of you to weigh in at any time, because I think you all have something significant to offer. And we're also going to try to dedicate the last 10 to 15 minutes of this session to questions from the audience. So as we're proceeding, please think about any questions you might have for this group. The first for Rhonda and Robert, what types of partnerships have you have been particularly helpful in your time in South Carolina for the success of your organization?
Well, first of all, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here today. If I may, I'd like to first tell you a little bit about the company I lead, Afaxys, so it creates some context around my comments. Afaxys is a first-of-its-kind socially conscious pharmaceutical company. We're headquartered here in Charleston. We focus on serving public health providers across the country. We estimate about 30 million patients every year get their health care there. And we focus on sexual and reproductive health care. It's about 10 million of them. As our primary goal, affordable access to all the products and services they need, so the caregivers can focus on caring for the patients. Now, with that as context, we started the company, my co-founder and I, back in 2008. And to be quite frank, neither one of us had ever started a company before. I came from the big pharma, and you know that's a big infrastructure that supports you as you try to develop your work. And so she was the CFO of the team, and her first agenda item was, we need a good accounting firm. And I know it didn't sound sexy or exciting from a partnership point of view, but I have to tell you, I'm going to call out Elliot Davis, because we interviewed a plethora of firms in South Carolina, and they rose to the top very quickly, not just for their technical expertise, but they were aligned, you know, in the head and the heart with what we were trying to accomplish. They have been with us for the last 14 years, from the very early days of, you know, just the financial infrastructure to where we are today, which we're now 12 products in market. We're about to launch a $30 million cap campaign, and we never could have done this without them. So from a partnership point of view, I think they have been amazing, strategic thinkers and partners with us every step of the way.
Excuse me. So a little bit of my background. We came down to South Carolina about 5 years ago. My wife's born and raised down this area. Been in the pharmaceutical for a long time. Liked to start up companies. Had a company up in North Carolina that I've started that was at an early stage. I would call that a seed stage. But we were able to get venture capital money, and we actually sold our company. We only had 6 people in development within about 2 years for a little bit over $1 billion. So wanted to get down here and start another company. So one of the things we looked at is a lot of programs, and we looked at probably over 100 programs. I was hoping to get into oncology again. That's been one of the main areas that I've focused on. And you saw up on the slide earlier, Nancy DeMore. So that was a program that Dr. Du Bois had brought to us, and we started looking at it. And to me, you know, and I've developed a lot of cancer therapies. I think it's going to be change the paradigm of how cancer is treated. So we're real excited. We're going to have a significant raise. We have our offices in Mount Pea, and we should be in the clinic probably within about 9 months, not only in bone cancer, but in pancreatic cancer, triple negative breast, and also multiple myeloma. So we're very excited down here. It's a program that I think is going to be going to grow and grow. We'll bring other programs in. So I think, as you were talking about partnerships, you know, MUSC, we had looked at a lot of programs, and that was one that was clearly the best that we've ever seen.
And Robert, you've had some success in fundraising as well, I understand.
Fortunately, we have. You know, either with investors, either they love you or they loathe you.
Sometimes both.
But you know, up in North Carolina, we had spent about a total of about $22 million. And like I said, the exit was about $957 million in about 2 years. So the investors were quite happy. So we have investors for down here. And I think the key thing down here is to continue to get investors to put into these startup companies and get them into the clinic. And that's, you know, the nice part is, you know, we have a lot of contacts. And there is more interest now in putting VC money down into South Carolina.
Any other panel members want to tackle that one? Okay, sounds good. So what types of areas of support have you had to go out of the state to acquire, and what can we do as a state to draw in those types of resources into our boundaries? That's for you as well.
Oh, that's for me. Okay. Well, in North Carolina, even though North Carolina has some VCs, our funding was actually from California, from VCs. The VC that's funding our whole program here is actually from out of state also. So I think the key thing, you know, it would be nice to have some VCs that actually have significant funds to bring, you know, in South Carolina. But the nice part is there are resources outside that you can access.
Well, we certainly over the last 5 years have made progress as a state in growing new firms like Good Growth Capital, but then attracting in firms like Cultivation Capital and BIP. But point well taken, we still have a ways to go there. Rhonda, do you have any answer to that?
Like Robert, our funding came from outside, California mostly, but predominantly the West Coast. So I look forward to seeing more of what you just described, because as we launch this next growth phase, obviously home capital will be fabulous. So if any of you are sitting in the room, thank you very much for being here.
And then finally, for the two of you, and then you can sit back and relax. With regard to our ecosystem, what challenges or barriers have you encountered, and were you able to successfully overcome those, and how?
For us, that has actually been twofold. One was investment capital. So having to go external, we look for impact investors, given our social kind of basis in our company. We've been successful in doing that, so I'm hopeful now that that will now lead to the next phase, which is more local or at least regional funding in our next growth phase. The second has been expertise. When you think of the presentation that was just made, if you recall the Valley of Death, I think Dale called it, we're on the other side. We're the commercial side of the Death Valley. And that expertise has required us to import a lot of the talent, because when you're building from a startup phase, you build your high-level talent and then build it out as the company grows. So the Northeast predominantly is the pharmaceutical hub. You know, New Jersey, Massachusetts, Eastern Pennsylvania, and California. So we've had to import talent for the most part up to this phase. And to do that, we actually, you know, we use three things. One, we use the mission centricity of the company, because as we're attracting pharmaceutical expertise, there are people within the industry who that drives them as well. Obviously, it's very competitive in the life sciences space, so we have to use a very competitive compensation structure. And we use Charleston. I mean, Charleston, what, number one city to live in, travel to, and that is a draw for many of our candidates.
Well, I think, if I remember the question, some of the challenges. So obviously, getting venture capital down here. The good thing here, there's a lot of fantastic technology. We've looked at a lot. The downside is a lot of people don't know about it outside of the state, and I think that's a good challenge to try to get people more aware, bring investors down, have conferences and things, because that's one of the limitations. You know, up in North Carolina, obviously, it's very well known. And the other thing, too, I think the nice part is that North Carolina has a lot of expertise more on the development because of all the CROs, but I think leveraging that and even bringing some of the CROs down here and having them, you know, like the Quintiles of the world, which is now IQVIA, and they'll probably change their name again, but bringing them down and having satellite offices, it just gives more, I wouldn't say credibility, but more interest from the investment side to put into South Carolina.
And towards that end of getting the word out, Secretary Lightsey recently informed me that later this year, the state is going to host a mission trip to Silicon Valley. Plan on participating in that. It's a good start, but not sufficient, right? Yeah. Any responses from the rest of our panel on those,
sure.
Those questions?
Jeremy? So my name is Jeremy Mercuri. Just to give you a little bit of context of my comments, some of the challenges. I'm actually more of a faculty entrepreneur. So I'm an associate professor of bioengineering at Clemson, but I'm also the chief scientific officer at a company called Samaritan Biologics. But I'm relatively new to the entrepreneurial side of things, not necessarily as a faculty. So I had more challenges learning how to start a company and what the mechanics are of doing those things. Just like the keynote speaker said, I spent a lot of my time in lab developing technologies and teaching and writing proposals. So learning about how to get a company off the ground, get a technology out, where are those resources? I learned day in, day out, certainly through SCRA, SC Bio, all the resources here. But one of the ways I overcame or I'm continuing to overcome the challenges of starting a new company is finding mentorship. And finding folks that have done it and have been successful and can give me input, and I found some folks here. And one thought that I also had from the university perspective to also forward that and move that path forward is if we had things like entrepreneurs in residence, for example, at our university or in our department. We don't have one of those right now. But again, I've been fortunate enough to find some folks who've been willing to mentor me who have been successful over time.
Thank you. Question for Ken and Chris. So input and access to clinicians is absolutely vital for early stage life sciences companies, but often it's difficult to get that access. How can a company do that in an effective way? And then once they do achieve that, how do they maximize that interface.
Thanks. I'm Chris Carr. I'm an emergency physician practicing clinically at MUSC for 28 years now. And I think I'll deviate from the question a tiny bit and just say that as clinicians, boots on the ground, we have tremendous vision. We dream about, wouldn't it be great if, dot, dot, dot. And so I was fortunate enough back in the early 2000s to say, wouldn't it be great if I could see the medical records from my patient who was at this hospital two weeks ago and this other hospital 2 weeks before that. So I was part of a group from MUSC that was funded by the Duke Endowment to establish the Charleston Area Health Information Exchange. And we did, so how we did this is I gathered a group of ER docs from all the other hospitals and said, hey, well, what do we think this should look like? And there were no vendors back then where you could just buy a health information exchange. We literally partnered with an informatics company and made this HIE, which was truly life-changing. And it still exists today in the Charleston area only. So the clinician part was the what's in it for me and what's in it for my patient. So if you are an industry person and you want a clinician to come in on their own time most of the time, so they've worked their 60-hour work week, and then you want to ask them what should we do about X, Y, and Z, you have to do the with them, the what's in it for me. And for us, it was how does this make patient care better? But we started this HIE with grant funding, as I'm sure all of you know, that ends. So into the Valley of Death we went, and then Ken Deans moved to South Carolina and was the incoming CEO of Health Sciences South Carolina. We recognized very quickly that although this was a great clinical thing, and every clinician would stomp their feet and scream to mommy if it didn't work, the funding was ending, so we partnered with Ken, who brought in the informatics experience, the financial experience, the infrastructure, I would say. And candidly, we're still sort of in the Valley of Death. The politics of South Carolina are difficult to take this across the state. Now there are vendors that would like to come in and such, but maybe we'll talk about that in a minute. But to get the clinicians to partner with you all to advance whatever project it is, it has to work for your patients, first and foremost. We will do anything to make our patients' lives better. But also, what we did with our HIE was very quickly started publishing the value in improved efficiency, in tremendous avoided cost, in avoided duplication of studies, which resulted in less radiation, and then we linked that to the decreased lifetime attributable risk of radiation to cancer. And so all of my publications on my academic hat are what is the value? And clinicians can help you publish that. We can say, this is the value, or this is your value proposition. We do great with vision. And dreaming. We do great with the future. We know how this is going to impact us, but that intersection of opportunity and potential, we do terribly. We cannot seize the moment because we don't have the knowledge, the fund of knowledge that you all have.
So can you expand a little bit on the reference to our politics? I'd be derelict if I didn't have that follow-on question.
Well, the truth is, so moving forward, I think that's why we're here, is we need to hardwire relationships with politicians, with lawmakers in general. That happened with COVID. I'll say Ken and I have this HIE, and I'll tell a very quick story. So COVID is awful. In the very beginning, I also work with the South Carolina Hospital Association, and I see my boss over there, Thornton Kirby, but we recognized very quickly that COVID testing was awful. Patients were stuck in these community hospitals that didn't have what MUSC had, where we were able to develop a test and use that test. And if you recall, we were running out of PPE. So we had a COVID patient in a hospital. We did a test, and the turnaround time for that test was anywhere between 5 and 7 days to get it back. In the meantime, the nurses and family members are having to churn through the masks and the gowns, which we ran out of. And so we very quickly said, well, this is easy. The test goes, you have to report a COVID test to DHEC. DHEC had a hard time getting the tests out to the providers, and how it actually happened, let's say, I don't know if anyone's from Spartanburg, but if you're in Spartanburg, you had an infectious disease nurse logging on every single patient to the DHEC website. It wasn't a dump. It wasn't pushed to you. So we said, well, why don't we just provision access? Why don't we hook up with DHEC and provision access to every single provider in the state and say, here's your COVID test. There's no delay. The politics took about 3 months to make that happen. The technology part took about 30 minutes. So I feel like if we had better daily relationships with lawmakers and frankly industry, when things like this happen, we would be much stealthier in doing that operation piece, because we can think of it and we know how to fix it. We just can't get past that valley of death to sustain it.
Yeah, I think Dr. Carr summed it up quite well. I mean, we all know all business is based on relationships, engagement, and advocacy. The problem is you can't start those three things after the fact. You have to begin engaging now. Venues like this, you know, offer the opportunity for business and academia and others to come together, and I think that's where it starts. But specific to your question, Bob, related to clinicians, I think Dr. Carr enumerated it quite well. The reality of it is there has to be a value proposition. That's the what's in it for me. You know, what I want, when I want it, nothing more please is what we like to say. If you can provide that value and demonstrate that value, then I think the relationship's easy. Now, my other simple answer would be to that, Bob, is hire somebody like Dr. Carr, right? Somebody who's passionate about what they do, passionate about their patients, doesn't mind engaging with all of the above, and I think that's the solution. But you can't do that, again, you know, only when you have a need. I think you need to start that relationship building long before you ever get to the need or the ask.
So towards that end, a question for the entire panel, and this is a curveball. I didn't mention this in the prep. There are a number of us in the room that regularly interact with the General Assembly. I'll be in State House next week. If there was one thing that you would like from the General Assembly to improve our standing of the life sciences industry in the state, what would it be?
I'll take a first step. Based on North Carolina, the biggest thing in North Carolina is the state funds, in this case it's NC Bio, quite a lot. This state doesn't. So I think that's one of the first key things, because you need the money to be able to expand your base and so forth. So I think investment from the state in, and like I said up there, it's done through NC Bio, but do it through SC Bio here, I think is a key one.
Okay, so this may not be a popular thing to discuss, so I'll just put that out there first. So forgive me if I offend anyone. I moved to South Carolina 20 years ago. I love it here, so let me say that up front. I love all the people. I love everything about it, or I wouldn't still be here. And I would definitely not have started a company here. So with that said, I do know, because our footprint is the country, the whole country. We're represented in all 50 states, Guam, Puerto Rico. There is a perception about South Carolina that actually is not true, but there is a perception, you know, when you read the national rankings of things, we rate really high when it comes to great restaurants and where do you want to vacation and livable cities, but when it comes to education, you know, our national rankings are just not as impressive. And that perception kind of permeates outward when you're building a life sciences, high expertise, high education kind of industry. historically, our elected officials have not invested heavily in education. That has not been a primary focus of theirs. And so I think, you know, from my vantage point, I think it may be time just to challenge that historical perspective and say maybe, I know I just heard, I think this a couple days ago, there's discussion going on about a $600 million tax decrease. I personally have enough shoes in my closet. What benefit I may gain from that, I would prefer be invested in education, actually. So that's just my personal, I wish, when you go up to Columbia, that maybe we have a challenge of our historical investment strategy.
And I'll be sure to give you full attribution when I bring that up. Others?
I have two asks. One is just the $40 million that we need to get our HIE moved across the state so that every single hospital, hospice center, skilled nursing facility, et cetera, can transparently and frictionlessly exchange information. But that's my small ask. My bigger ask is that we are a small, incredibly collaborative state, and we're stealthy, and we could get a lot of things done. But we need the politicians. So perhaps the formation of a think tank or something that involves leaders of some of our large associations. We have Clemson, we have USC, we have these amazing universities. Let this group inform legislation. It was awful to see the kind of, I'll call them fringe physicians, testifying, having more time than us academicians and people that are somewhat informed about ivermectin and about, it was horrible. But the truth is, where were these politicians gonna go to have a trusted source of evidence-based information? There, to my knowledge, that does not exist right now.
Very good, thank you.
Yeah, you know, I would add to all of that actually a little bit. The reality of it is we've had some pretty robust engagement with our politicians in the State House. We're fortunate enough to be headquartered in Columbia, and our experience has been they are very interested in improving all aspects that we're discussing up here. I think, though, what we need to figure out a way to do is to bring the business community, the legislative area, as well as the governmental agencies together. Because when we talk about what can government do, I don't think it's just legislative side. I think it's the agency side as well, because the reality is we engage more with the agencies, or need to, than we do with the legislators. And then I think once we figure out the proper mechanism to build that alliance and that collaboration, the second step is to really, when we're seeking to solve a problem, is do what we all know to be true and figure out what is that question zero. So for example, if we look at education, how do you tackle that? We can throw more dollars at it, and sure, there's never enough dollars in education, but what causes children not to learn? You know, do we go and look at some of the social disparities that may exist throughout the state? What about food insecurities that may exist? Because if you can't eat, you can't learn. If you can't learn, you can't develop. If you can't develop, you don't get to this conference. And so I think those are the big picture items that we really need to focus on. So that would be my ask, is figure out how to bring us all together.
Thank you. You good? So commercialization of R&D out of the universities. What's going well, and where are some areas where we can improve? And I'll direct those to the last three on our panel, but you all are welcome to weigh in.
So I take that from, the academic perspective and where I've seen success and what's going well. So I think of that in three different kind of buckets or elements. So first, I've firsthand seen several of my colleagues who have been doing a lot of bench work and discovery work for the last 15, 20 years, recently over, say, the last 2 to 5 years, partner with local entrepreneurs and companies to try to push those technologies out and really translate those. So I've seen that. There's, you know, a couple faculty in the room that have done that recently. But I also see the partnership in academia success in other ways. So I spent a lot of my time teaching. Actually, I direct a Master's of Engineering program at Clemson in bioengineering. Actually, a bunch of students are in the back corner. They're looking for jobs, by the way, so they are getting educated and trained in medical device development. So that's your guys', tout there. But I've seen entrepreneurs and local medical device professionals partner with our program, partner with our students, whether it's giving guest lectures or it's mentoring them in development project meetings or having lunch with them and mentoring them and really stimulating in them, one, this experiential learning to educate them better, but then also to stimulate them to be entrepreneurs as well. And then just one other example where I've seen it being successful, this kind of collaboration from a project perspective, this Master's of Engineering program, these students develop medical devices over a year. They develop prototypes. And most recently from our student teams last year, there has been interest through collaboration with the South Carolina Medical Device Alliance and a local entrepreneur who essentially has stepped up to be a fractional CEO to push this technology, to start a company on it and to move that forward. So there's a bunch of different elements or a bunch of different facets of success that I've seen when academia and entrepreneurship comes to together.
For those of you that aren't familiar with the South Carolina Medical Device Alliance, it's a collaboration among MUSC, Clemson, and SCRA, under which we take technologies developed by students and researchers throughout academia, but now actually more broadly to include PRISMA and others. And we have a panel of industry experts to down-select that group to the most commercializable, the most impactful. We then have the university, if it's coming out of a university, protect that intellectual property. And then it's advanced to a more commercial state by a group of Masters of Engineering students at Clemson, as well as business students, all led by a professor of practice, with the then outcome being either commercialization or licensing of that technology or the creation of a startup company around the technology. And that's funded in part by a grant from the U.S. Economic Development Administration. Others, in terms of answers to that question?
I think that was well summed up. I would add, you know, the reality of it is, and Bob and I have the luxury of serving together on an EBSCOR state committee board that is focused on graduate students and initiatives in the research space. And that includes, you know, most of the universities that engage in research from around the state, many of which you see here and on the board. The reality of it is there are incredible ideas coming out of students in these universities. So whether it's through these associations or it is direct engagement with every university in the state that engages in such research scenarios, I think it's incumbent upon us as businesses of South Carolina or investors in businesses in South Carolina to really drill in and dig in and create a relationship with those institutions. We have an annual event where I don't know, there's a thousand, maybe not a thousand, many, many hundreds of students presenting the work they are working on. I would encourage the group to find out when those sessions exist around the state and attend them, because as you walk through line by line and look at all the incredible work being done, that is your recruitment location, that is your R&D location, and so forth. I mean, it's fairly remarkable, and as businesses, we just got to tap that, because I see all the academics and the researchers there, but I see very few businesses there, and it's really unfortunate, because that is IP waiting to happen.
So. That state conference will be held in Columbia, I believe, April 22nd. Jim Doolittle, the state director of EBSCOR, is here. He can shout out and correct me if that's incorrect. That's correct. Okay, very good. Thank you, Jim.
I'll say two things. One is, I'm a clinician. I'm different than Nate and Jeremy in that my research is just, I have an idea and we need to make it happen. And to get funding, I need to publish papers. So that's my research. But there are, I have the dream job. I work for the Hospital Association. I touch every hospital in the state. I also work in health information exchange to make, ideally, patient care better for every person in the state that seeks care, at least in an organization. But I take care of patients. Every day at work, so many of my colleagues are like, how can I do what you do? They really want to add additional value to their work. And in emergency medicine in particular, but a lot of these high intensity fields, we need something else. We need to sustain our career. So I will tell you that there are clinicians, tons of them, email me, that would love to sit with you at lunch, at dinner, and just talk. The second thing is getting things out. A quick story. I think that meetings are really good, but we tend to assemble in like groups, like all of you are business people. And when I go to meetings, I'm with a whole bunch of ER docs and things like that. I was a medical director for like 1,000 years of the ED at MUSC, and in doing so, we did multiple renovations, and I had to work with DHEC and blah, 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 so I got into how wide are your hallways, how bright are your lights, all this crap. But I ended up on this national committee called the Facility Guidelines Institute, which is the body that says how wide your hallways need to be, how bright your lights need to be, how wide your doors need to be, et cetera. And going to those meetings, I met a guy, Dave Allison, who's a architect guy. I think he's the chair at Clemson, maybe, of architecture. He said, hey, will you come talk to our human factors engineering people at Clemson? I was like, sure. And he said, just think of an idea. And this is how things happen, these meetings. So I said, well, here's my idea. In healthcare, in hospitals, they are dirty places. Touching all of these surfaces makes me insane. Why can I not walk into a room and say, Alexa, show me Ken's x-ray, and have it show up on a wall behind a glass? And why can't I say, Alexa, turn lights on. Alexa, turn monitor off. Alexa, I have to touch everything, and think about the labor to clean that room, and do they really get clean? And, so we talked to these human factors kids, and they came down, and we started this great collaboration. There are three of them. I've mentored three of their masters in human factors engineering now, have gone on to work in the healthcare space to develop touchless. Back then, we didn't have the hand sanitizer thing. You had to touch it. So all the studies showed that the most contaminated thing in a hospital is the little hand sanitizer thing that you do that. I'm not kidding. That is published data. So this girl, Allie Hobbs, did this like this is 10 years ago. All of these, so these meetings are really constructive, but perhaps diversify them and have a day here where you have like bright idea day or something. I don't know.
That's a wonderful idea. By the way, under your Alexa scenario, Google then have all that data, which they'll monetize. But
anything to share on that question? All right. Let me.
The only thing I would add is I definitely will not touch the hand sanitizing station on the way out.
I never touch them. I carry my own in my pocket.
Let me open it up to the audience for any questions that you might have. Yes, ma'am.
I am no translation of, intellectual property kind of person, but I will tell you, so when things like that come, what we do in the hospital is we bring the patients into a room, and we bring the nurses into a room, and we bring the providers into a room in a very kind of non-threatening and just dialogue. And I'm not tooting my own horn here, but you get someone who's passionate about that product, someone who has lymphedema, who needs this device, whose life is improved, and get them to squawk and, you know, squawk and squawk. And then the business part is these guys.
I personally have found that it's this unrelenting focus and, you know, a level of perseverance that I think sometimes defies itself, that you just don't give up, that dogged determination, no matter how many people tell you it can't be done, no matter how many people tell you you won't get funding. It is that deep-seated passion and unrelenting focus, and I think that applies to any entrepreneur, actually.
You know, one more thing you might consider too, you know, we're supposed to stay high level up here, but if we want to, if we can drill down a little bit into the weeds, there's this whole concept of inbound and outbound marketing, which I'm sure you're aware of. You know, the goal ultimately though is for people to come to you, right? Instead of you trying to go find them, you need to engage yourself and put yourself into groups that are very specifically focused and targeted on your area of interest or your area of product offering. And don't just sell right out of the gate. Become an expert supporter and helper in all of these different communities, whether that be social media communities or that be in-person communities. Become to the point where you are seen as somebody who is knowledgeable and is willing to help others without seeking something in return. Ultimately, then, when you establish that level of credibility, and you come up with a solution to a problem, then you can offer that solution, and you've already got a following and a base that's interested in that. So I would engage yourself in that way in a targeted way as you can.
I'm just gonna make one comment from the business side. I agree with what you're saying, but I think the key thing you have to be careful on, if you've got a great idea and you start sharing it, other people are gonna take that idea. So. If you have, and again, you need resources, but make sure you can patent it and protect it, because if you can't protect it, there's all your value right there. And if it's a good idea, other people are going to look to knock it off. So, you know, I'm looking at it more for the commercial side or later on partner side. So really make sure you do that before you go out and share it with the world.
Great advice.
Maybe even before you talk to potential investors.
Exactly, because that's one of their questions they're going to ask.
Others?
We've heard a lot in the last couple of days about the policy issues at the state level facing us, and I think that affecting those changes is going to take the actions of many people. And I was wondering if you guys, as leaders of very small and very new teams, can talk about how we can integrate things like advocating, building awareness in the biotech community locally and nationally
I'll take first step on that. I think two things. One is getting people to realize what's down here. And that's including bringing VC groups in. It's bringing in people from the government, you know, that type of thing, people from the FDA. The more visibility you can get down here, and like I said, I've looked at a lot of technologies down there, and they're outstanding. But a lot of people don't know about it outside of South Carolina. And if you can bring the interest down here and bring the investors to realize that it's more, and I think the other thing that's key down here is you're developing products, but you want to get them into clinic or into patients versus we're going to take this technology early and just flip it and get biobucks down the road to show them that we really want to make these programs into viable commercial entities at some stage. That's really what we need to do.
I'll take a different take on that. So one thing I've learned just stumbling through this great idea and this great project is to leverage existing government relations. So in my case with an association, or in our case with Health Sciences, we hired a government relations guy to help us, because that is a whole nother world and a whole nother language. An example of something that we came up against, transmitting health information. Many of our legislators were like, well, you can't do that. That's against the law. And of course, there are many federal, the ONC has really come up with standard data use agreements. This is not a new thing, but in South Carolina, it is a new thing. So we needed a trusted government affairs guy to liaise between me, who's like, come on, you dumbass, like, this is a no-brainer. And the politicians really don't like that. They really don't. So you need, like...
You're feeling the passion now, right?
Yeah.
Is there press in the room?
Yeah. You need, like, a calm lawyer type, you know, to interface. And so I have learned in my second half of my career, we have many associations in the state, like the South Carolina Primary Healthcare Association, the Office of Rural Health, the South Carolina Hospital Association. This is what they do, and it's what they do well. So leverage that, partner with them, talk to them, say, hey, what would you recommend? Because this is all they do, and this is why we have great hospitals in South Carolina.
Yeah, I think it's establishing that government relations connection and liaison between the tech speak versus plain English and, you know, how we can advance things in the state. And then seeking to create public-private partnership with all of the above that were mentioned, and then do the same process, but perhaps to the VC entities that are out there, making them aware of what's going on here in South Carolina, because I think there is a lot going on that just isn't seen outside of our four walls, so to speak.
I think we have time for one more, if there's one out there. Oh, yeah.
Well, I think a couple things. The VC, especially if you don't have a track record, it's a numbers game. So it's really, you know, you may have to contact 100 different groups. But at that stage, if you also have people that have had no investors, and, you know, you can get through the bottom level before you have to go five levels to get to a person that's even going to screen it, utilize those people that have done that, because they have the contacts with the VCs, they have the respect with them, and that gets you to a much different level initially. So I think that's one of the key ways, because if you don't have a track record or knowledge, it's tough. It just really is. But leverage your resources that you have here, I think, is a key one.
I also think it's using the relationships you have, because I think that seeds itself back into where, if it's one thing that we've all talked about, it's the relationships that are built. And I know for us at Afaxys, that's how we were able to do our initial funding, and it's where we are right now. It's where those relationships were initially built. Those relationships took us to the West Coast. And because that's where these large pots of interest sat. So now, you know, I do hear conversation, though, now percolating in South Carolina that I did not hear back in 2008. And I think, actually, it's part of you. I think SC Bio, it's an opportunity for SC Bio to accumulate the capital, whether it's through good growth capital or some other organization like that. I think it's a simmer that someone just kind of flicked up the fire, and it's about ready to go to a boil. So I look to you, obviously, and I'll help you in any way I can, but I think it's a great opportunity for SC Bio.
Let me ask our panel just anything else you want to share with our audience before we wrap up.
It's great to see you. I say, wouldn't it be great if this room was five times its size and we had a greater representation here than what we see today even? You know, we saw legislators in the audience. We saw directors of government agencies in the audience. I think that should be part of our goal.
I'm just going to add one thing. One of the things I see with students, whether it's undergrad, grad, med students, whatever, is having the opportunity to get industry experience. And again, I'll just pitch what we're doing. We're going to be offering some intern programs during the summer, and it doesn't matter what level it is, because one of the key things I don't see down here, unfortunately for the students right now, is what it, there's a big difference between academic research and regulatory development. And having that opportunity to really understand what the nuances is, and that's one of the little things that we're going to do to try to, at least for people that really want to see, is it an area that I want to look at or I want to potentially go into? So that's something we're going to offer at our company.
I'll tell you all something you may not know. At MUSC in the medical school, I don't know if Cephas Simmons is here. I think it's the second year of medical school. There he is. Just correct me if I'm wrong. It's the second year of medical school. Every single medical student is required to do 3 months of a research project. That is very loosely defined where they do it, how they do it. And my daughter is a third year medical student, and they struggle to find opportunities. We in academics, I gotta say, I always am, can I shadow you? It slows me down clinically, it's more work, I am inundated as an, and you probably are too, as an academic clinician / researcher. Students drive me insane, but if it was just every now and then, but there's so many of them. So anyway, it would be great. We have a new dean now, a guy named Terry Steyer. Ray is taking over and kind of elevating his role at the Hollings Cancer Center. But it's a tremendous opportunity to get students into your, whatever it is you're doing.
Chris, you win the Quotable Quotes Award for this session. Please join me in thanking our panelists.